friends, it's Bernadette. I am the creator and channel and publisher of the Arc Animal Tarot and Oracle Deck, as well as whatismyspiritanimal.com. And this video is answering the question of where has Bernadette been since basically October of last year. And for those of you who know me or follow me online, you know I am an incredibly Scorpio-esque private person. But due to the nature of where I've been and what happened and what is continuing to happen, I was urged by the animal kingdom to share the stories with you because in October, I'll just be out with it, I almost died. I was literally, literally minutes away from dying. And it was a spirit animal that saved my life and an angel who passed along information prior to that. And just this whole series of events that if I didn't have witnesses, credible witnesses, I might have thought I was really losing my mind. So it's a bit of a long story, and I hope you'll stick with it because just the sheer miraculous magic that happened is profound to me anyway. And I've found, as I've started to get heal and get better a little bit at a time, that telling the story to the few people that I've told it to, they've either expressed at the time, oh my gosh, I wish I'd have known this or been able to recognize this or see this during this moment in my life or someone I love's life, or they've rung me back at a later time or emailed me and explained, when I took a look at this situation, or I allowed myself to see this message or accept this message, it was life changing. It just changed everything for the better. So maybe grab yourself a cup of tea, a beer, some wine, whatever it is you drink, water. And I'm going to start at the beginning, and I'm just going to ramble through till the end. So, but before I do that, I just want to say thank you to all of you who wrote in. And when the first newsletter didn't show up in December, and the second newsletter didn't show up in January, and the Spirit Animal Scopes didn't show up, so many of you wrote in to ask if I was okay, and was there anything that you could do? And not knowing if I, you know, if I just quit, or if everything was okay or not okay, you extended such compassion and kindness. Oh gosh, I promised myself I wouldn't get teary, and here I am, 5 minutes into this video. I thank you so much. And also along the way, so many of you have written in once you got your decks, you know, in November and December and into January. Those of you that have, you know, supported Kickstarter, thank you. Those of you that have purchased them subsequently, so many of you have written in and just thanked me for creating the deck. It's truly the most humbling thing of my life. And I you supported us and still thanked me for creating it. And so the thanks goes right back to you, and the animal kingdom was a collaborative effort, and it will continue to be a collaborative effort now that I know I'm not going to die. Yay! So here we go. I'm going to be completely transparent, something that's very difficult for me. And so, yeah, here we go. So in the middle of designing the deck, yes, it's another plug for the Arc Animal Oracle, but it took over 2.5 years, y'all. In the middle of designing the deck, I went to bed, normal me, and woke up with my hands and my knees swollen 5 times their size, and the pain was excruciating. I couldn't move them. Now, I was diagnosed with an autoimmune disorder 5 or 6 years ago called Sjogren's syndrome. It's not even a disease, it's a syndrome, for gosh sake. And I'd been pretty much asymptomatic. The weird events that happened to even get that diagnosis were, well, weird. And so I really kind of poo-pooed it as just a, you know, teeny tiny obscure whatever. So I go to my doctor. She immediately sends me to a rheumatologist. I'm looking at her like, I don't need a rheumatologist. I go, they juice me on prednisone. Swelling and pain just dissipates within a few hours. It was a miracle. And then everything got worse and worse and worse and worse. And so through the Kickstarter, through the final design of the deck, I have to tell you, I relied on my spirituality in terms of my connection with spirit, totem, and power animals. Like, I never dreamed that I would in my life. And had I not, the deck probably wouldn't exist today because it was epic. And again, triple Scorpio, very private person. The only people that knew what was happening was my very closest friends and my family, because I was going to need some help at some point. Because after the kickoff of the swelling of the you know, hands and knees, the weakness started to set in, and muscle weakness and fatigue, and for no apparent reason other than, okay, well, now it's time for testing. And I have been tested for every possible autoimmune and MS and everything that you can imagine. And these bizarre, it just kept coming and coming and coming, and these bizarre symptoms would crop up. At one point, I had, it looked like somebody had taken a paintbrush with red paint and dotted all of my joints right here. They didn't hurt, they didn't itch, they just had these flaming red splotches on them. And because of the muscle weakness, oh, well, now we're looking at a muscle myositis. And now we're looking at this because you tested negative for this and you tested negative for this. Without going into all of the medical jargon, bottom line is I kept testing negative for everything that I was showing symptoms for. So the only thing that they could really do to try and get the swelling down and get me out of some pain and get me some mobility was put me on prednisone. And for those of you, and I know there are many, many of you out there that have had to take prednisone, on one hand, it is some miraculous, magical pill. And on the other hand, it's the worst stuff you can put, some of the worst stuff you can put into your system. So as the weakness is ramping up and the fatigue is ramping up, it just comes to the point where by, I would say, June of last year, I could barely get out of bed. And I was so weak. My muscles were so weak. I couldn't lift anything over 10 pounds. I could barely lift anything 10 pounds. And I thought, they can't find out what's wrong with me. I'm headed for a wheelchair. It was tough times. And in the meantime, now I'm wearing a heart monitor because I've got an AFib situation, and my heart would just randomly start racing. And it would feel like it was, the way I describe it is, if you put Michael Jordan's tennis shoes in a dryer and tried to, you know, dry them, that whap, 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 thud, thud, thud. It really felt like there was something, you know, my heart was coming out of my chest. And so I'm wearing a heart monitor. And the next thing I know, I've got an AFib situation with a thing called RVR, which is, it's a rapid heartbeat. And my heartbeat was just racing continually, 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 24 hours a day. So my option at that point, while I'm still answering questions from the Kickstarter, trying to get the people in China on track, trying to get everything that I need to do on track, it was a special, special time. I got told, well, you can go on medication. And when I took a look at, because I've never been on meds, you guys, you got to understand, I grew up a country girl. If you had a headache, you almost never had a headache. You were almost never sick. So I really do have the constitution of the proverbial ox. So for me to hear, you're going to have to go on these meds for the rest of your life. And then I research the meds and call doctor friends of mine and be like, okay, what's the real story with this? I was horrified. I was like, I don't think so. What's plan B and what's plan C? So I was told, well, the next plan is we can take you in and shock your heart back into rhythm. Okay, you know, people get the paddles every day, right? That seemed pretty okay to me, except for there's not a, I mean, there's no guarantee of anything, right, in medicine, but that wasn't going to help potentially the rapid heart rate, which was extremely high and going almost 24 hours a day, as they figured out from the heart monitor data. And they said, or you can have a thing called a heart ablation, which is where we go into your heart. Sorry, go into my heart. And we find the offending cells that are causing this. We burn them, basically. And then we hope it works. It works in some ridiculously high percentage of patients. And as long as you take care of things afterwards, you know, no caffeine, no this, no that, whatever, you should be okay. And I was like, well, and then I did a bunch of research on that. I choose that one. We'll do that. The other two, why try something that doesn't work with the, you know, paddle thing? I am not going to go on those medications. That is not happening. The side effects are, I'm not doing it. So now I'm scheduled for a heart surgery at the end of August. And in the meantime, all the muscle weakness, all the fatigue, everything else is getting worse. And I thought to myself, okay, listen, animal spirit guides, I know who to call on as a power animal. I know my totems inside and out. I need you to send me the spirit animal or animals that are going to see me through this, because I knew intuitively that just having that heart surgery, it's not a surgery, like they don't cut you down. They go in other ways, so on and so forth. They call it a procedure. I call anytime somebody is going to touch something in my heart and burn something in my heart or potentially freeze something in my heart, I call that a surgery. So I went into a deep, 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 I would call it trance, in this enormous stallion, very deep cinnamon color, appears in front of me, but I can't see his face and I can't see his body. I can only see his chest. So the horse asked me to put my chest to his and just stand there for a minute. This wasn't a huggy, huggy Hallmark moment. This was a put your chest to mine and just stand there for a few minutes. Okay, I did that. Now, I, you know, do as I say, not as I do, right? I'm always on you guys. I always write about it. When I do spirit animal readings, I'm always telling people, why didn't you believe that? And look at what it's turned out to be, so on and so forth. And in Bernadette's head, I grew up in Ocala, Florida, the horse capital of the world. And I'm looking at a heart issue, and this horse wants me to stand chest to chest with him where the heart is. And I'm like, really? You of all people, Bernadette, you're making this up. You're just, you know, listen, you got to figure this out. And then I moved on, had other things to do. So in the meantime, while I'm getting everything prepared to do the heart thing, my rheumatologist comes to me and says, listen, we're going to have to start looking everywhere for a potential cancer, because a hidden cancer, a cancer, could be causing the same things that are happening with the fatigue, with the muscle weakness, with some other things that were going on. So we're going to start at the top of the list. And sorry, I'm going to talk about girly doctors. So fellas, if you're sensitive, or even ladies, if you're sensitive, you know, close your ears. But first stop is mammogram. So I was a terrible patient last year. I hadn't scheduled my mammogram or my GYN appointment. And now I've got to get them both at the last possible minute. And I have an amazing, amazing, amazing GYN. And I have an amazing, amazing, amazing doctor for my mammograms. Neither of which could I get in with. They're booked months and months in advance. So I call on the spirit animal world. And sure enough, that horse shows up again. Only this time, he is hauling butt through a field. Okay. So I call back in the next day because I didn't want to see any of the other doctors. And without taking time at each point of this story, because this spans since August of last year through now, any time that I wanted to see a specific doctor, every single time they were booked. And every single time I would call back in the next day or 2 days later, Miss King, we had a cancellation. If you can come at such and such a day at such and such a time, we can see you then. And three times I'm on the phone with the girl trying to get a see if there's a cancellation at several different doctor's offices. And while I'm on the phone, she refreshes her computer screen. There was a cancellation while we were on the phone. So as these events started to occur, I thought, well, intuitively, I already knew this was going to go from bad to worse, and I know it's going to be okay, but I've got to be prepared. I have got to shore up. I've got to man up, put on my big girl panties. This is all going to go very south. I couldn't identify what was going to go south, but I knew it was going to. So I go in, have my mammogram, and it is early. You guys, I go early to doctor's appointments. I hate waiting. I hate waiting rooms. You know, it's always flu season somewhere. Don't want to be around people hacking and coughing. So it's 7:30 in the morning. I walk out of my mammogram, and I look over to see a friend of mine, and I'll change her name to Susie. And I said, Susie? And she turns around and she looks at me and she screams and she jumps up out of her chair, her pen and her notebook go flying, and she rushes to me and just hugs me so tight. And I'm like, are you okay? Because I had just come out of getting my good news, nothing chest related, that no masses, no nothing that they could find, got a clear bill of health on my mammogram. And she said, I just can't believe you're here. I just cannot believe you're here. And I'm like, it is kind of a weird coinky dink because she owns a bakery and I haven't been there, you know, haven't been there in a while. I've been really sick. And she said, I thought about you and thought about you. And I was like, you know, I love you, but why are you thinking about me when you're getting a mammogram? And she said, do you remember a few years ago when, you know, you guys were at the bakery and I was really upset. I just got a phone call that my cousin had been diagnosed with a fairly aggressive breast cancer and that it runs pretty diligently through our family and I'm just terrified. And you told me that you looked at that moment and looked years and years ahead and all you could see was clear flowing water. You didn't see any of that. She said, this is, and she's in her 40s, and she's been so terrified to find out that there's a mass, that there's this, that there's that. It was her first mammogram. She was scared to death. So she said, your being here tells me that everything's going to be okay. And she said, because what are the odds we're going to meet at 7:30 in the morning at the same doctor for a mammogram? And here you are. And you're the one that told me years ago, it's cool. It's cool. Well, you know, listen, it's just like teachers learn from students. I learn from clients every day and friends. And the minute she said it's all going to be okay, I wanted to be present for her so I didn't lose my poo. And, you know, but I wanted to lose my poo because I knew it would be okay. I might be going through hell and back, but it was going to be okay. So that was the first story. I've had to keep a list. So if I look away, I'm looking at my phone. Okay, so Now we're going to fast forward to, I'm in this crazy weakened state, and it's time for my heart ablation. Ready for this, you guys? All right. So in between the mammogram and when I've got to go to my GYN appointment, they schedule the heart ablation. I go in, they ablate my heart, which is, you can look it up. I won't go into the details. And when I'm in the recovery bay, because it's general anesthesia, they knock you out, obviously, I hear a voice say, "Are you Richard Gorenberg?" Oh, excuse me, Dr. Richard Gorenberg. Now, I was still heavily sedated. I couldn't move. But the look on my face must have been quite something, because my nurse came flying over to me. "Miss King, are you okay? Are you in pain? What's wrong?" And I looked at her and I said, did I hear someone right there ask that fellow if he is Dr. Richard Gorenberg? And she said, "I can't tell you due to HIPAA laws." Well, I just went into shock, and here's why. 30 years ago, I had an ovarian cyst and an ovary, and it was misdiagnosed. There were other complications, again, that I won't go into, but I was living in Orlando at the time, Orlando, Florida, and I had to call my sister, because everybody except for me has worked, well, everybody's retired now except for me, so worked in the medical profession at some level, and my sister was a researcher for a lot of years. So I call her, I explain everything, she says, "Oh no, you have to get to Gainesville right now. I'm going to get you in with the best GYN here, Dr. Richard Gorenberg." So I go in, and this was before cell phones, this was before anything. He sends me for x-rays, he palpates, and the next thing I know, I'm at my sister's house, and I get a frantic phone call. She was at work for my sister. "You have to go to Dr. Gorenberg's office right this very minute. Get in your car and drive right now." Whereupon he told me that I had an ovarian cyst, and that if I didn't get in for surgery like tomorrow, or it could even happen tonight if it ruptures, he suspects it is so large, nobody could get to me in time, nobody. Even if I was in a hospital, it had to come out right then, and so did the ovary. So he takes it out, and it weighs 14 pounds, a 14-pound ovarian cyst that I never felt any pain. I mean, I've always been chunky, so I just figured, you know, I was gaining some more weight. I didn't detect a mass in my body, and I took dance, ballet, tap, and jazz for forever when I was a kid, years and years and years. I'm pretty body aware, and I just, again, asymptomatic, never felt it. So that cyst and pictures of it made it to all the medical journals across the country, but and a picture of it, this, anyway, it was incredible. But that man saved my life. And my sister saved my life. But I'm used to that. My sister has literally saved my life, like, I don't even know how many times. From the time I was a baby, and she came in from school one day. She's 8 years older than I am. So she came in from school. She's like 8 years old. She couldn't find me. She had a funny feeling. And the babysitter had left me in the bath. And I'd fallen forward. And I was face down in the water. Couldn't breathe. And anyway, there's like three or four other times. So thank you to my big sister. I don't know what our sacred contract is, but thank you for saving me. And I'm still here at 54. So he saved my life. And there he was 30 years later in the recovery bay right next to me. And the lady just happened to say, "Are you Dr. Richard Gorenberg?" Or I would have never known who he was or why he was there. I mean, I don't know why he was there, but anyway, if that's not a sign, you guys, and as I have often said, humans are animals, hence they can be spirit animals. I don't know what that is if it's not a sign. So my sister gets there, I'm telling her the story. we took 3 more minutes to be amazed, and now we're going down a checklist of, okay, what is this trying to tell me? We're, okay, well, I knew the heart thing was going to be fine, and sure enough, just as a side note, it didn't even, I had it's fine. Surgery went great, and I highly recommend a heart ablation to anybody who's having real trouble with AFib, if it's an option for you. I really do, because the RVR stopped just like that. The AFib stopped just like that. Pretty crazy stuff. Okay, so what I didn't put together, because I'm an idiot, is that he's a GYN. And he detected an ovarian cyst that had been misdiagnosed and saved my life from an ovarian cyst. I never put it together that I was going to my new GYN, because he long since retired, he's about 1,500 years old. I never put it together that I was going to my new GYN, she's been my GYN since he retired almost a decade, the next week. Never put it together. Duh. So remember now, I'm ticking through all of the things that I have to tick to, because now I've got this in the back of my head. They're looking for cancer, because all the other autoimmune related stuff, even though I show symptoms of like a dozen different autoimmunes, are testing negative or a point or two above the threshold. So I go to my GYN, and I was a good girl. I went last year and the year before and got a clean bill of health. And she says, you have an ovarian cyst. And I said, of course I do. And I told her the story of Dr. Richard Gordonberg. And she just looked at me. And of course, she's a doctor. And, you know, I don't think she's really into metaphysics, or maybe really even the kind of spirituality that, you know, I share with you all and you share with me and, you know, lots of other people around the world. And she said, well, it has to come out. And 5 years ago, I went in for a surgery that was supposed to be just a routine hernia surgery, protruding hernia. It turned out to be a pelvic tumor. All hell broke loose. They called her, my GYN, they called in a cancer specialist. And she goes, look, you're lumpy. And I really think you should just get a hysterectomy. And I'm like, well, okay, if that's what you really think I should do, then, you know, let's do it. It's not like I'm having a baby at 54. So I just also want to say, I bring all of that up because if you haven't investigated it yet, each zodiac sign is governed, or the zodiac sign governs, or the body governs the zodiac sign, different parts of the body. And for a Scorpio, anything in the reproductive area is always something to look out for. For other signs, it's this. For other signs, it's this. So really get to know those things. Take some time after you watch this video or whenever, and just get to know those parts, and just maybe pay some special attention, or if someone you know is having problems in those areas and is a particular zodiac sign or whatever, you can help them out. So, okay, now we're scheduled for a hysterectomy. And in the meantime, I'm over 50, I've got to have a colonoscopy. And in the meantime, I've started dropping weight, not like that's a bad thing, but because I couldn't keep food down and my esophagus was closing. And it was just this whole GI drama. So now we're going to have an endoscopy. So before I get to those surgeries, now let's talk about the muscle weakness. Y'all, if I could get in my car and drive to the grocery store, which is 2 miles from my house, I had to lift my legs with my arms into the car like you would see a quadriplegic do. I couldn't grocery shop by myself. I mean, it was just, and it was getting worse. But at that point, when they're looking for a thing called a myositis, or the causation for muscle weakness, they can look at a bone marrow biopsy, and we weren't there yet. But they do two other tests, a blood test and then a nerve conduction test, to see what's going on in your muscles, in particular in your legs. And they just kept testing negative. So finally, God love my rheumatologist, he said, that's it, we're going to do a muscle biopsy. So October 17th and 18th are two of the days that have changed me forever. And I hope that the rest of this story will be very helpful to you in some way, should you ever need it. My greatest wish is that you never ever need this information, or a reminder of working with spirit, totem, power, animal energy. So now we've got these surgeries scheduled. I'm 2 weeks out, and I've got to have every test known to man. I've got to have MRIs of this and CAT scans of this and this and this and this and this, because in their genius, all of my doctors decided that I should have an endoscopy and colonoscopy one day, general anesthesia, and the hysterectomy and the muscle biopsy in the same operating room next day, also general anesthesia. Well, somehow they failed to remember the weakened state that my immune system was in. Nobody ever thought about it. I didn't think about it. Doctors didn't think about it. So I'm in my garden about a week and a half before the surgeries, maybe a week. And I don't know if you guys have ever seen the plant, an angel trumpet. They are the most beautiful flowers that get about that big and they hang like bells. They're gorgeous. If you haven't seen them, look them up online, angel trumpet. So I'm standing out in my little secret garden on my little patio, and I'm working with the animals, except for no animals come. I keep getting this horse that keeps showing up over and over and over again, and I'm trying to be accepting of this horse. It's not like I don't know what horse symbolism and meaning is. It's not like I don't know 1,000 myths and great stories about horses. It's horse. It's a horse. It's one of the most popular spirit animals. And I grew up in Ocala on and around horse farms. We had horses when I was a kid. Come on now. So I look up and I'm looking at the top, because angel trumpets can be 12 feet tall, taller than that. And I'm looking at all the beautiful blooms at the top. And I went to look down, like I'm looking up, right? If you look at my eyes, I'm looking up, and I tried to move my eyes down like that and they stuck. I couldn't move my eyes. And now all of a sudden I've got vision that's starting to blur and get double. And I'm going through the checklist. Am I having a stroke? Am I having a seizure? What are your other symptoms? Stop, feel your body. You know, I'm doing the Google doctor, armchair doctor checklist. But before I passed out, and I didn't feel faint, but I thought, I do not want to hit this pavement and whack my head on one of these planters and die, because I whacked my head open. And I very gingerly sat my way down to the ground, closed my eyes, and periodically kept opening them. Well, I just couldn't move my eyes. And I thought, this is a muscle issue or a nerve issue. This isn't a vision issue. So that went on for 5 or 6 minutes. And when I got into my house, I immediately called my eye doctor, my optometrist, told them what was going on. They had me come in that afternoon. And of course he dilates my eyes. Now keep in mind, I was in my garden looking at angel trumpets, which I dearly love, and they're everywhere in my yard. So on the dilation, he says to me, you've got spots on your retinas. They've never been there before. You need to see a retinal specialist right now. And he referred me to someone. They got me in the next morning. And I go in, I see the guy, and he says, these are garden variety cotton wool spots, which we see in people with long-term diabetes, which I've never had, don't have now, autoimmune issues, and you're in the middle of, you know, you told me your whole medical history. And there was one other thing that I don't remember. I think it's heavy drinking, alcoholism or something. Not me either. So I have to report that to all of the surgeons. And now we've got to get a clearance from the eye doctor for me to be able to be go through these surgeries because of how they have to tilt you, do this, do that. And in the meantime, I had an MRI of, I don't even remember whatever, scheduled. So I go down to one of our imaging places here in Gainesville, Florida, where I live. And I started having a literal out-of-body experience while this MRI was going on. Now, keep in mind the words garden, where I was, and angel trumpets that I was looking at. And I have a bizarre, strange, creepy experience with the x-ray tech. I mean, I really thought this lady was going to slap me at some point. She just was talking to herself, belligerent about nothing. I mean, all she had to do was shove me in a tube and tell me when to breathe and not breathe and take the pictures, and we had to be done with it. But she just kept picking at me for whatever reason, and she wouldn't give me the prompts. And, you know, finally I was like, is there a problem here? Do you need to take me out of this tube and get another tech, whatever? And, you know, I didn't really care what the personality thing was and she was going through. I didn't care. I cared that my images were going to be what they needed to be because of the status of my health. So we finally get through everything and I'm on my way out the door, and I just, this nagging feeling, and almost like there was an energy literally pulling me by the back of the collar. You've got to tell the person in charge. Okay. So I go to the desk. I'd like to relate an incident that I just had. May I speak with whoever it is that's in charge? Sure. So lady comes out, we shake hands, we go into her office. I explain to her what happened, and she said, I'm so sorry. We are having issues and we are taking steps to rectify that situation so that no one else has to have that kind of experience. Okay, great, thank you. So I'm about to get up and leave. And that conversation took maybe 4 minutes. And I watched this woman look at me, and she's engaged as a manager supervisor. She blinks her eyes and it was like pod people. It was like someone else just took her over, and she leans towards me and she says, you know, I lost my daughter-in-law about 6 months ago. Now I'm like, God, is this woman a client, a reading client? Has she been to me for a psychic reading, a mediumship reading, and I just don't remember her? And I'm panicking, thinking, I can't not remember this poor lady. She just lost her daughter-in-law. And Gainesville's a small place. I mean, if you're looking for a psychic or a medium, there's only a handful of us here. And I'm everywhere on the internet in Gainesville because, you know, the internet's my thing. And I've been doing it for so long. And I just, you know, I said, no, I'm so sorry, I didn't know that. And she launches into this story, and I'm sitting there holding sacred space for her, understanding she needs to talk about this. And she explains the story of her daughter-in-law, who was admitted to one of the hospitals here with cirrhosis of the liver, which they didn't know until she collapsed. They got her into the hospital and tested her. And in comes the ER doctor, who says, gee, you're really young to be such a drunk, and proceeds to not treat her, proceeds to just explain to her that she's gonna die if she doesn't stop drinking. And she's like, you don't understand, I don't drink. And now the kid goes septic. And the next thing you know, less than 2 days later, she's dead. And as the woman's telling the story, all she kept saying, because what I ultimately found out, what they ultimately discovered, was her little brother died at 12 of a rare genetic liver disorder. Her mother has been fighting this her whole life. And where the disconnect was between that family information and the doctor and whatever, she told me, it made sense at the time, but honest to goodness, I've been through so much, I don't remember. And also that for me, that wasn't the important part of the story. What the important part of the story was, if this woman said it once, she probably said it 15 times during, because we were together for an hour. She told me the story for the next hour. Miraculously, even though she's the head cheese at this place, her phone never rang once while we were there. Not once. Now, maybe she turned it off and I didn't see her, but I don't think so. And we're just sitting there in like this vacuum of unbelievably powerful energy. And again, what she says are these words. It was not garden variety. There was nothing garden variety. They didn't look where they should have looked. They just assumed that it was the obvious things, and that's what killed her, but it wasn't garden variety. Well, when she said that enough, I went, yeah, I'm not missing this sign this time. I know going into my own story of surgeries and biopsies and more testing and more testing and more testing, they're not looking deep enough. It is not garden variety. Okay. So then she says, would you like to see pictures of her? And I said, of course I would. She goes, well, they're boudoir pictures, but they're not, they don't expose her or anything. Now she's, it's not like she didn't have my attention and compassion before. It's inappropriate and unprofessional in the extreme to offer up pictures like that. And there's nothing unprofessional or inappropriate about this woman. She is the consummate professional. And I knew that she was there as much for me as I was about to be for her. So she pulls out these pictures, and this absolutely stunningly beautiful girl was in this angel costume, brilliant white feathers. Now, this wasn't one of those cheesy, you buy them online. This thing looked like it had been made for a Hollywood production of some kind, a Broadway production. It was stunning. And, you know, angels, in my opinion, can, you know, they can be, look like anything or anybody. But this kid's hair, the blonde, and her eyes, the big blue eyes, I was like, if ever anyone was the poster child for angels, it's this kid, early 30s kid to me. And then I knew, I'm like, I've got angel energy surrounding me. Now, I believe in angels maybe more than the next person, because I have two stories in my life that honestly, they, you know, because I'm not the usual angel type. So the people don't write me and say, what's the type? You know, there's no such type. Everybody can be an angel person. Yes. But as you guys know, my thing are spirit, totem, and power animal energies. Like, that's my thing. So I look at this and I thought, okay, I've got angels looking out for me. This girl showed up through her mother-in-law to tell me to be on alert for the term garden variety. Not garden variety. They're not looking deep enough. They're only looking at the obvious. Okay, got it. Thank you. A billion blessings to you both. And out the door I go. I get into my car and my phone rings and I recognize the number. It was my optometrist. So I answer the phone and he says, Bernadette, this is Dr. Dreyfus. I said, am I in trouble? I said, because you're kind of acting like I'm in trouble. He goes, no, I just want you to know, I've been an optometrist for 40 years. I know what cotton wool spots look like. I got your report from the retinal specialist. There's nothing garden variety about these spots. I'm telling you, you have something drastically wrong in your immunological system. It is bad, 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 bad. And you've got to tell your doctors they've got to look beyond the obvious. I stopped breathing. My heart stopped. I just was in such a state of shock. I thought, Okay, of all of the messages that I've missed, poo-pooed away, not believed, not acted on, I promise I will discover, I will be aware, I will know what it means when someone says this is garden variety. I will say, no, it's not. Well, in the meantime, I look up and out my windshield, there stands the horse. I still couldn't see his face. I still couldn't see the rest of his body. But his mammoth and the color, I just can't even describe this color, this cinnamon brown, God, beautiful, deep, rich. I'd almost call it a jewel tone, except for it's cinnamony brown. And there he stood. I got it. Okay. So now we've had an angel appearance. And we move on to next week to the surgeries. Yeah. So, bottom line is, get through 2 days of surgeries and general anesthesia. Get home after the hysterectomy because they cannot move you out of that hospital fast enough. They need the beds. And if you can even be coherent or walk to the potty, you're great. See ya. Out the door you go. Get home, collapse. Just collapse. Now, my sister, again, my lifelong angel and lifesaver, was with me, as well as my gorgeous, gorgeous, beautiful, amazingly accomplished, yes, I love her niece, who happens to be an ER trauma nurse. So they get me into my bed and we're deciding, should I go back to the hospital? And the subject of dehydration comes up. The subject of over-anesthetized comes up. You know, we're going through the whole things, every possible thing we can think of. We're taking my blood pressure. We're measuring my oxygen. And, you know, none of it good. But I just got out of surgery. And my numbers were good enough that they booted me out, not even a half an hour before. And I did not want to go back to the hospital. You can't know how I didn't want to go back to the hospital. See, for those of you who don't know, in 97, my mom was killed due to medical malpractice, medical negligence, unproven in a court of law, but they pulled the wrong medical chart, treated her based on a complete stranger's medical chart, and lo and behold, she has a massive heart attack and it kills her. I wouldn't be a metaphysician if that had not happened. Now, I understand my mother is just one story, but again, my whole family's been in the medical profession. I could tell you stories that would make, even though you think you might know the status of healthcare in our country, I could tell you stories. So now we're deciding, and we decide we'll give it just a little while more. But I've got to go potty like nobody's business. So they try to sit me up, and out I go again, and that was it. My niece was 911. We need a paramedic. We need an ambulance right now. So I come to, and I thought, oh my God, I'm dead. I've died. This looks nothing like what I thought it was going to look like. Because y'all, it was a slow day in Alachua County. And in our county, when the paramedics roll, so does a fire truck. And in my room, there were 15 of the hottest guys I've ever seen, all in uniform and all standing there like this, looking at me, who wasn't bringing sexy back. I was in a unicorn rainbow cat t-shirt. I'd just gotten out of surgery. I had my llama slippers on and harem pants big enough that if you guys remember MC Hammer Can't Touch This, I was not bringing sexy back. And I'm 54 and I'm fat, right? Not that being fat has anything to do with it, but or age, but I just was really feeling my age and just, okay, y'all, there were 15 hot paramedics and firefighters staring at me. And I thought the only thing that could make this better is if they didn't have shirts on and were holding kittens and puppies. That's all I could focus on. So, and they were all shapes and sizes, right? Okay, so enough about the firefighters and the paramedics. So there was an older fella, obviously, you know, the king of them. And he says, "Well, ma'am, what do you want to do?" And I said, "Well, I don't want to pass out anymore." And I said, "This is twice. There's obviously something wrong. There are things that we can't measure. We don't have the equipment." And I said, "I guess we're going back to the hospital." I said, "But I do what she does." And I pointed to my niece, who is standing there like this goddess, and all of these men, and this is not about women and men, but you guys know how it can be sometimes. And they're all looking at her like, "Who the hell are you? And why do you get to call the shots? And, you know, aren't you cute?" And I said, "But I do what she tells me to do." And he said, "Look, we see this all the time. This is probably just, are you ready for this? Garden variety dehydration. We'll hook you up to fluids. You'll be fine in no time." And all of a sudden, I felt this thrumming in my ears. I couldn't hear anything else that was going on. And the horse where that guy was, that horse's chest appeared. And I knew that this horse, the whole time, had been about freedom, which is why I'm wearing this hoodie today. Freedom. That's a whole other video for another time, but most importantly, at that moment, that horse was about travel. Now, I meant to pull the card. In the deck, which is based on the Rider-Waite system, and in most decks based on the Rider-Waite system, anybody that's using any kind of traditional symbolism from the tarot, the Chariot card has horses. And indeed, in my deck, it does. It has a black horse and it has a white horse. But the black horse has such overtones of that cinnamony color. I thought, at that moment, I thought, "Oh my God, that's where I recognize the horse from." And the white horse, white is such a divine color. I mean, all colors really are, but we associate the color white with divinity, angels, heaven, that kind of thing. I thought, "You dippity hoo-ha, you missed it totally." But travel, I said, "You put me in the bus." That's what we call the ambulance around here. "You put me in the bus and you take me to the hospital right now." That was it. They loaded me up and got me in the bus. And there we went to ER, where the ER doctor says, "Your systems are shutting down and you have no blood. You had a hysterectomy earlier today. And that was it, man. All hell broke loose." They called the surgeon. The next thing I know, I'm in a CAT scan. They're thinking that I'm bleeding out internally somewhere. And it was weird because, you guys, the power of your power animals, I'm telling you now, it is, you could call forth strength from within you. And you know, we know the stories, the moms, the dads, the whoever that lift a car off of their children, who show superhuman strength, superhuman clarity. They talk in languages that they have never studied, didn't know. I mean, the list can go on and on and on, but that was this moment for me, because after that, I never lost consciousness. After that, I was never not coherent, even though my body, my literal body, was shutting down and there was no blood in it. They were looking for blood everywhere and they couldn't find it. My numbers said that I should be headed towards shock stage number 2. They couldn't detect that, but that was because my mother couldn't speak for herself. She didn't have anybody there to speak for her. Now, I had my sister and my niece, but they didn't know the names of the doctors and all of the medical history as well as I did. No one but me could have told them that. And by God, I was gonna stay that way. And I called on bear energy like I've never called on bear energy before. So what that did for me was give me the strength to keep my mind where it needed to be while my body was doing other things, like dying. Now, psychically, in my emotions, in my waking, I didn't interpret it as dying, but my numbers, they were like, we gotta go, we gotta go, we gotta go. And the next thing you know, I'm signing a paper to have a blood transfusion. They couldn't find where the blood went. To this day, they still don't know where the blood went. And oh, by the way, the cyst that was supposed to be taken out from the ovary didn't turn out to be a cyst at all. It turned out to be a thing called a schwannoma, that they have no idea how it got clustered in next to that ovary. They have no idea where it came from or even how it could have been alive, because it was attached to nothing. It wasn't attached to a food source. Nowhere was it attached in my body. And now they can't find the blood. I didn't bleed that much during surgery. My surgeon was like, yeah, we were super surprised and actually laughing about it. She bled more from the muscle biopsy than she did the whole hysterectomy. And it's just a mystery, but in the meantime, you know, my hemoglobin, my hematocrit, my everything was in the toilet and flushing fast. So had I listened to that paramedic, had I not had the incredible gift of that angel, that young lady working through her mother-in-law to tell me, don't listen to them when they say it's garden variety. Make them look deeper, which is essentially what that whole message is all about. I'd be dead, because I again, literally minutes away. Now, might have there have been a massive heart attack or a stroke somewhere in between there? Yes, absolutely. And quite frankly, they were pretty surprised that there hadn't been at least something. But I was on death watch for the next 2 weeks. So now we're October 17th, 18th, and 19th. We're moving into the time that the arcs are showing up, and I've got 1,200 decks to ship out. I couldn't live. I was bedridden. There wasn't anything I could do. So my angels, a good friend of mine, Rebecca Blair, who supplies all my rocks and crystals and Zuni fetishes and animal totems, we've been friends for years, and my sister saved my hiney and worked literally around the clock. Because when the arcs finally got here from that slow boat from China, we wanted everything out before Thanksgiving. And I was going every other day. My sister was having to basically lift me out of bed, put me in my car, get me to get blood work, because they're monitoring my blood like nobody's business. They couldn't get my hemoglobin up. They couldn't get my hematocrit up. Severe anemia doesn't even begin to cover it. And in the meantime, my midsection swelled up about the size of a very, very large beach ball all the way around. And I'll spare you the details of the hematoma. It just looked like somebody had taken a ball bat and just went to town. So during that time, I had a big surprise with my spirit animals. I was so weak in my body, not in my mind, and not in my spirit, but I was so weak in my body that I surrendered. Now, that's the first time in my life. And when people talk about, you know, if you would just surrender, oh, I hate the concept, never wanted to do it, never understood it. But I was like, I'm giving this up. I've made my wishes very clear. And I am calling on you all to help me. And I never saw such a bevy of baby animals come at one time. You think you've seen a lot of those on Facebook? You should have seen them fill my room. And I'm looking at all these baby animals running around and I'm like, oh, I get it. Okay. And I asked the spirit animal world, I said, are you sending me babies because it's my time to be a baby? Meaning children don't question, you know, until they get to a certain age, children don't question that someone is taking care of basically their every need because they cannot do it for themselves. Even when I was on death watch, literal death watch, for 2 weeks. That's a term that'll get your attention. It just used to irk me that I couldn't get up and get a glass of water by myself. I'd have to call my sister, who moved in with me for a few weeks, about a month. And I'd be, can you get me the water? Ooh, guys, for somebody like me, I'd rather suffer physical pain. Don't know why. But I decided that was it. I was not going to make myself stressed or have more pressure on myself to get to heal, to find the answers, which, by the way, was at this point, we still have no answers for the autoimmune thing, right? Now they're just trying to make sure I don't die. And I decided for the first time in my life to ask for help when I needed it. Now, judiciously, but I just decided there are people who love me very much and have explained to me it is hurtful to them when I don't allow them to help or I don't ask them. So I did it. And as you all know, November was the last newsletter I sent out. It was already ready, you know, and it was sent out. And then December rolled around and January rolled around. And now we're in the middle of February and I've just been so sick until literally this past week. I just couldn't. And by the time I've been through that much trauma and I still don't have answers, I still have all the muscle weakness, I still have all the fatigue, I still have, I just didn't. I'm sure I could have found a way, y'all, but I just didn't. So if I owe you an apology for just disappearing on you without an explanation, I apologize. Truly, I do. If you don't feel like you need an apology, and you understand that sometimes even people that are always the strong one, always the one that other people can have a moment in their life where they're like, I could have found a way, but I was baked, just totally baked. And not really sure what I could say, which really was the crux of it. What am I going to say? I'm sick. Here's what's going on. I'll keep you informed as I live through this. I don't know, man. I've seen other people. I have what is my spirit animal in the Arc Tarot? Are very fortunate that I have a very large list of people who care about that subject matter. And for some kooky reason, you guys like what I have to say. Which always mystifies me. And so that's a lot of people to be responsible to, not for, but to. And I just, you know, I didn't know. I just couldn't make a decision. And so I didn't. Now that I have answers, now that things are better, and I believe they'll continue to get better, I will keep you more informed. And I'll keep you more informed. And now that I can sit in a chair, slap on a little face, make my hair kind of look like it's not as fried as it actually is, or that I've lost as much of it as I actually have, life can continue. So once I understood I needed to be a child, I did. And I have never had cave time like I craved this time, true to my bear totem power spirit animal energy that is always with me. I just can't even remotely describe to you how I needed to be sequestered away. So long story short, if I heard the words garden variety once, after things started to get better, because a transfusion, there's obviously reasons they give them. And I was concerned, you guys. Again, I don't get sick. I've never had to have the medicines other people have had to have. I've never had to have a transfusion, that kind of thing. And, you know, listen, you're receiving other people's blood, there's a transference of energy there that I think has to be taken a look at if you are a psychic, a shamanic worker, and anybody that works in the metaphysical or energetic field, because you are literally putting a physical manifestation of other people's emotions, their likes, their dislikes, their whatevers into your body. And just because somebody's got great blood doesn't mean they're a great person. And I was freaked out to have a blood transfusion for just that very reason. I didn't know what it was going to do to me psychically. As I wrote in the last newsletter, I was on hiatus until after the first of the year, never dreaming that the autoimmune thing was going to ramp up and get so much worse after the surgery trauma, drama, llama, and it did, and that I was going to be out of commission as long as I was. I never dreamed. And so I haven't done, I've done maybe 3 or 4 readings since August of last year, because if I'm not clear, if I'm not healthy, if I'm not strong, how am I going to journey into other dimensions or make contact with whatever is out there? You guys, that takes a lot of electricity from your body, literal physical electricity. And I couldn't do it to myself, but more importantly, really, was I'm known for my accuracy. There's reason for that. And if I didn't feel like I was going to be able to be that accurate and get you the information you needed, So I haven't done any readings. I'm hoping to start doing readings again. You guys have been very understanding and I appreciate it. I'm hoping to do readings again starting in mid-March. My family and friends who don't even know that I'm up and about today, looking like this, having the strength to sit here and do this video and whatever, they're going to be so happy for me. They're going to be so stoked. I'm happy for myself. I'm so stoked. But I hope that it's the big turning point. And there's no reason to believe it's not, because I started this drug called methotrexate. And for those of you with autoimmune issues, then you probably know what it is. And again, it's like prednisone. I mean, in 3 weeks' time, I can lift a 20-pound bag of cat litter. I am still fatigued a bit, but that's mostly the day or two or three after taking the methotrexate. And I'm having other epic, like GI problems and that kind of thing. I don't know if you can tell, but I lost 50 pounds. Yay for me. Not the healthy way to do it. But I did. I've lost 50 pounds in basically 4 months. But I would lick the parking lot of the hospital, and I will continue to have these GI problems as long as we can figure out some other way to mitigate it, to be able to have my life back, to not be bedridden, to not have to look at, oh my God, am I going to be in a wheelchair? To not have to look at some of the things that other people contend with on a daily basis. And I'm so very grateful that it's looking like that's not going to be me. Now, back to the autoimmune. And I want to talk about this. I know this video is very long, but pardon me, I've got to have some water. I now have the diagnosis. Ready for this? A highly complicated, like ask anybody who's ever dated me or been married to me about highly complicated, they'll go, she needed a doctor to tell her that? That's a diagnosis? Please, they could have just come to me. Overlapping autoimmune disorder set, something like that, including Sjogren's syndrome, which we already knew that I had, rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, and an undefined muscle myositis. Okay, so here's why, and they may add others to that list. The reason I'm going into all of that is not because I need to tell my story about, oh, this is what I have, and I'm learning not to identify as these diseases, so on and so forth. Sorry, I got a cat here somewhere. It's because they diagnosed me because my numbers in those areas, finally went enough above the marker, the threshold, the top threshold of, if you go over this, we need to look at this, you can be diagnosed with this as this. There's still only that much over it, which having Sjogren's can show those kinds of positive numbers in those other areas. But because the symptoms have been so bad, so big, so you can't deny them, this is not psychosomatic, it is what it is. That's how they were able to put me on the medication. And in the absence of that, Bernadette would still be in her cave wondering what the rest of her life is going to look like and not having any answers. Now, about 3 months ago, a friend of mine asked me, had I ever heard of a thing? Well, actually, it's Dana Winters. You guys know, you should know Dana. She does the astrology zodiac article for Building Beautiful Souls every month. She's a dream interpreter, amazing tarot reader that I refer to. Anyway, if you don't know her, check her out, Lucky Frog Tarot, and Dana Winters. Check her out on Facebook. She's an incredible reader and my soul sister of soul sister of soul sisters. She asked me, had I ever heard of a thing called shamanic sickness? Nope. What's that? She said, well, when you're basically, you're dying or almost die, or you have some psychotic break and some schizophrenia thing, something, it can be mental, it can be emotional, it can be physical, and you have some crack in your system and nobody thinks you're ever going to come back from it. And one day you're back and then you're back for forever. And the next thing you know, you're a healer. Well, but no one knows what was wrong with you. That really took me back a few pegs because I happened to be in Sedona before all the poo hit the fan last year. And I'd never been there before. And I went to two or three unbelievably credible readers, each in their own discipline, one an auric reader, one a hand analysis person, not a palm reader, but a hand analysis person. And then a gal that was just a straight up psychic medium who chases UFOs everywhere. She's very cool. And each one of them told me, as well as my astrologer, Janine Castle, she's amazing. She's in Australia, just an amazing, amazing astrologer. They told me there was going to come a time shortly in the next year or two that I would end up doing more teaching and healing than reading. And I said, no, that day is never coming. Because Bernadette is not a healer. And oh, did I get lectures? What do you think your readings do? What do you think this does? What do you think that does? But it's not a formal kind of thing. But, you know, the result is the same. Okay, I'll give you that. That's an intention that I set before I do readings. Okay. But this was like, no, no, no. This is like, you are a shamanic blah, 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 blah. And here Dana is telling me about a thing called shamanic sickness. Now, I haven't been able to find too very much on the subject, but at the end of the day, the bottom line is this. You get really sick. You have no idea what's wrong. The doctors don't know. And then through whatever process, one day you're fine. Okay. My day happened to start the first time I took methotrexate. And now I can look at other ways, additional ways that I can incorporate, not to get back to the Bernadette that I was. I'll never be that Bernadette again. And I'm not talking physically and, oh, I have limitations now. It's not like that. What it is that the lessons that I've learned, the wisdom that I've gained, and maybe even the level of gratitude that I now live in constantly. Yeah, I'm a different person. So I'm going to do more investigating about shamanic sickness because you guys, through what is my spirit animal and now through the Arc Tarot, I get hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of emails. And, a lot of them, enough of them have come through. The doctors can't find out what's wrong with me. Why can't I get better from this? Why can't I this? I think there's something there that I'm supposed to uncover. And what's weird is, why do I say that? I'm in this business, even I still say it. There's a teacher named Maureen Mernon who has been teaching at the Arthur Findlay Academy, my beloved Arthur Findlay in England, for 25 years, something like that. And her particular bent is shamanism. And for decades, she would come to the States once a year and bring a group of people. And they would go to, I don't recall which one she told me, but there were a couple of the reservations in Arizona that they used to stay at for a week and a half or whatever, and work with the folks there. And even just at the end of last year, she was in a yurt. You know, this lady's in her 60s. She was in a yurt somewhere in, I don't know, over in Europe somewhere. But I was like, this is crazy. She does a thing called medicine wheel readings. And right before everything really hit the fan, I had signed up for private lessons with her because I had a medicine wheel reading decades ago before I ever knew about metaphysics, believed in metaphysics. And, you know, it struck me at the time as pretty accurate and it was kind of interesting, but it was the gut feeling that it gave me. I've never forgotten it. And I haven't been able to find anybody that did medicine wheel readings. I couldn't find them online. It was just the places that you send your $45 or $75 to, and they send you out some printed page, whatever. I could do that. I can buy a software that does that. Forget it. So the medicine wheel reading I had with her was one of the most significant readings of my life. And so I am putting together medicine wheel readings that are designed to give you a heads up, almost a blueprint of where you're at that moment, or if you want a year forecast. And they are all centered around deep, deep healing and looking at your soul's contract, what you signed up for. You guys, I believe in these readings. Like, I can't even begin to tell you. And as soon as I get my package put together, as well as I feel today, I hope to have it together by the time I start giving readings again in March, mid-March, which is, I hope that today is not an isolated incident, that I continue to feel this good or better. And I hope, and I know this has been a long video, I don't even know, it's gotta be like an hour and 45 minutes or something, I don't even know. I hope that you watched the whole video so that when an animal comes to you in whatever state they come to you, because I poo-pooed the horse for forever until angels intervened. Because remember, I had to go to my eye doctor because I was standing in my garden, not garden variety, looking at my angel trumpets. I had to go to my eye doctor because of that. And then I had to circle back around, and then I had to have an MRI because of the cotton wool spots and the this and the that and the, and it just was this whole circular, it was a journey. It was, the horse took me safe in the chariot and ferried me everywhere I needed to go. My GYN from 30 years ago who saved my life showed up in the recovery bay right next to me at the exact time, on the exact day. And the lady, his nurse, are you Dr. Richard Gorenberg? I came out of anesthesia. I mean, I had just opened my eyes. The timing. We're not talking one thing. We're talking dozens of things. The doctors who I couldn't get in to see, who the assistant refreshes the screen. I can get you in tomorrow at 7 a.m. Can you be here? Yes. I can get you in tomorrow at 5 o'clock. Can you be here? Yes, yes, yes. The Mayo Clinic. Without the Mayo, I love my rheumatologist here in Gainesville. I trust him implicitly. But without the Mayo Clinic and that doctor going, this is crazy. This should have been treated like this, you know, that's it. This is the plan. And here we are. I wouldn't be here to tell this story. The other thing that has been told to me by the animals, because, you know, I expected a lot of animals to show up, a lot. Bear, babies, horse. That's it. That's what I got for the past, since October. Bears, babies, horse. That's it. Things that I expected, thinking, you know, I've been doing this work for a long time. I know how this is done. Didn't happen that way. Things that I didn't expect, I'm embarrassed and I'm disappointed in myself and I'm confused as to how I could be so blind in some respects. Who lays in a recovery bay after heart surgery, has the GYN that saved their life sitting next to them, and doesn't equate that with, oh, you're having a GYN appointment next week? Who does that? I just didn't put it together. Long story short is, over and over and over again, the universe, the angels, the spirit animals, they were conspiring to keep me here. Now, something I have to take a look at is, why was part of my sacred contract to come so close to leaving? Again, it's not the first time in my life, all due to illnesses that I didn't even know were there, like another ovarian cyst, like being an infant and falling face over into the water, and a couple of other things that have happened along the way. What is that all about? Now, I understand that Scorpio is death and rebirth. Okay, but come on now. So for those of you that, you know, just come to the YouTube channel, my YouTube channel, just to, you know, casually, oh, I saw a hawk, what does it mean? This may or may not mean too much to you, and you probably haven't even made it this far into the video. But for those of you that are walking a really powerful spiritual path, and your animal allies are a part of that, I urge you, I implore you to take a note. I just talked to a gal the other day, and she said, well, you know, I know you're, just out of curiosity, do you see any animals around me? And I said, well, no, I don't. I said, I'm not in the zone, and I'm not getting readings right now. And I said, but the blinding white, the iridescent, sparkly white color that's around you has to do with whatever animal or animals are trying to get your attention at this time. She said, you know, it's funny you mentioned that. She said, just a few weeks back, she said, I was at a TJ Maxx or some other store. She said, there was a random snow owl figurine that just really caught my eye, and I just couldn't stop staring at it. And she said, and just a couple days later, I was at a shamanic workshop, and one of the girls there said, I see snow owl as your totem or your spirit animal. And I said, and now I'm seeing you surrounded by a blinding white iridescent color. I would really encourage you to start looking at the teachings of snow owl and see, you know, if it resonates now. Maybe it's just information to come. How could I have possibly known way back in August during a heart ablation issue when the horse immediately showed up, that if I didn't get in that ambulance and get to the hospital and I listened to that guy tell me it's probably just garden variety dehydration, I wouldn't be here today. The likelihood of my being here is like less than 5%. So it's been a long video. If you've gotten this far, thank you for listening. I hope it's helped you in some way. I just don't even have the words to thank you guys for your kindness, for your compassion, for your patience. I'm so very grateful, and I'm just so humbled that I promise you, as I get better, the work that I do for you, for the animal kingdom, it'll just it'll get bigger, it'll get deeper, it will get more consistent. So I love you all. I hope that you, if you are in a place where you are not feeling free, my greatest wish for you is that you do whatever work you need to do, take whatever steps you need to take, make whatever decisions you need to make so that you can set yourself free and you can stay wild. The wild is not out of you. You have taken yourself, for whatever reason, away from the wild, but it still is you. It still is inside of you. And I hope that you find that again. So thank you very much. And I will see you soon.